I know all of you know it. You are very intelligent students. So the full form of DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. Okay, so DNA is deoxyribonucleic acid. And what is the structure of DNA looks like? It is a double helical structure which runs parallel. Two strands run parallel to each other. Okay, and in between we have nitrogenous bases. So what is DNA made up of? DNA is made up of repeating nucleotides units DNA are made up of. And if you look into the structure of one nucleotide, so one nucleotide has three units. Three parts of the nucleotides are there. Now, which are the three parts of the nucleotides? That is, it has deoxyribose sugar. We are not going into the details of the structure, but at least these things you should know, that what is DNA, the full form of DNA, and what is DNA made up of. So DNA is made up of repeated nucleotides units. So we also call it a polynucleotide molecule. Why polynucleotide? Because it contains so many nucleotides. Polynucleotide, it is a molecule. So if you talk about one nucleotide, so one nucleotide contains three parts, that is deoxyribose sugar, and we have nitrogenous bases. And the third part is a phosphate group. One phosphate group is there in which phosphorus is there. So this is the structure of DNA. Phosphate group is there. Okay, this you should know, that DNA is made up of nucleotides, and one nucleotide has three parts, which is deoxyribose sugar, nitrogenous bases, and phosphate group. Now, I have told you that how many nitrogenous bases are there, because this is just the revision we are doing. We have already studied one full PPT presentation I have given you on DNA. So we are just revising that only. So how many nitrogen bases are there in DNA? There are four nitrogen bases. Okay, that is adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine. So these are the four nitrogenous bases which are present in the DNA. And out of these two, I told you that adenine always pair with thymine via double bond, and cytosine always pair with guanine via triple bond. Okay. And out of these four, two terms are more there which you should know. So adenine and guanine, these are called purines. Hum inko purines bhi bolte hain, theek hai? Purines. And cytosine and thymine, these two are called pyrimidines. We also call them pyrimidine. So if in the exam it is asked that name two purines of DNA, so then you will say adenine and guanine. And if it is asked that name two pyrimidines which are present in the DNA, so then you will write thymine and cytosine. So these things you should know. Clear? Then next is genes. What are genes? So genes are the part of DNA only. So if you look into the structure of DNA, it is a double helical structure. Two parallel strands are there which run parallel to each other. So if you just take small segment of DNA, so small segments of DNA are called genes. Okay, one gene, not genes. So a small segment of DNA is called gene. And what is gene made up of? So obviously if DNA are made up of repeated units of nucleotides, obviously then gene is also made up of nucleotides. And gene is a hereditary unit which carries the information for making proteins in our body. I told you that one gene will make one protein in our body that will control specific function in the body. Okay? So if there is an alteration, it can be the case that a gene can be a constant from generation to generation, or there can be sudden changes in the gene sequencing that is called mutation. So gene ke andar jo coding hoti hai, okay, that you will study in higher classes. So gene coding mein, if there is alteration, if there are changes in the gene coding, so then the genes will be altered, and that changes we call mutations. And if mutations are there, so if mutations are there, then there will be variations. So variations are there, then there will be more, you can say, survival, better survival chances are there. That depends on the environmental factors that I've told you, that there is a force of natural selection which selects the best fittest these organisms. Clear? So gene can be the same from generation to generation, or there can be alterations in the gene that is called mutations, which lead to variations. So only these you should know. And how many genes are there in 46 chromosomes of human? There are almost 30,000 to 40,000 genes present in the 46 chromosomes of human DNA. Okay, so these all genes, so if you say that 30,000 to 40,000 genes are present in 46 chromosomes, so the whole gene set, pura jo human ka gene set hai, we call it a genome. Okay, human genome. So the full gene set of the human body, that is called a genome. Clear? So these points are clear to you. This is the just the revision, because we have already done these things. So then next comes a very important topic, that is called sex determination in humans. Okay, sex determination in humans. So you know that male and female, they produce gametes. Okay, first germ cells are there, and then they produce gametes, and further when these gametes fertilize with each other, they form a zygote. So what is the probability of having a male child and a female child at the time of delivery? So that can be explained via genetics. Okay, how? So you know that how many chromosomes are present in the human body. So we have 23 pairs. Okay, in a human body, 23 pairs of chromosomes are present. Now if you segregate in male and female, so what is the nature? So in male, we have 44 plus XY, and in female, we have 44 plus XX. So now you know that these numbers are constant. Okay, these numbers are constant in both male and female, and these chromosomes, which are same in size and shape. Okay, these chromosomes, 44 chromosomes, which are same in both male and female, we call them, in 44 chromosomes ko hum bolte hain autosomes. Okay, and we call them homologous autosomes also. Why homologous? Because they are same in size and shape. So in male and female, these 44 chromosomes, these are same in size and shape, and we call them homologous autosomes. But these two chromosomes are different in male and female. So in male, two different types of sex chromosomes are present. We call them, first of all, we call them sex chromosomes. Okay. And moreover, one more term is there. If these are called autosomes, so these sex chromosomes are also known as allosomes. We also call them allosomes. Okay, now there are two more terms which are associated with male and female respectively. So if you say in male, so these are the two sex chromosomes which are present in male, that is X and Y. So you can see that both the sex chromosomes are different in male. Okay, so when both the sex chromosomes are different, then we call them heteromorphic. So we can say that males are heteromorphic. What do you mean by heteromorphic? Means when both the sex chromosomes are different in size and shape. So now if I'm saying that the sex chromosomes are different in size and shape, so which is larger and which is smaller? So always remember that if you say that between X and Y, which is larger? So X chromosome is larger than Y chromosomes. So X chromosomes has 100 more genes than Y chromosomes. Okay? X chromosome mein 100 more genes are there than Y chromosome. So that makes it larger. Okay? Y mein 100 less ho gayi. So there are no counterpart for these 100 more genes in X. So that's why X chromosome is longer and bigger than Y chromosome. So you can say that these two sex chromosomes, which are present in male, they are different in size and shape. So that's why we call them males are heteromorphic. Okay, different sex chromosomes, different in size and shape. And you know that now there are two types of chromosomes. Okay, so two types of chromosomes are means it is not like that only in one sperm both the types of chromosomes are present. So that means males, till now I have told you that male produce sperms. Okay, so males produce sperms. So they produce two types of sperms they produce. So that's why two types of chromosomes are there. Okay, so we call them heterogametic also. One more term we will give to males, that is heterogametic. So these terms you have to understand and remember also. So heteromorphic, when sex chromosomes are of different size and shape, and heterogametic means when the two types of chromosomes are producing two types of gametes are also there. So male are producing two types of sperms, two types of sperms they are producing. So abhi tak humne yehi padha tha na that males produce sperms, that's it. But I didn't tell you that male produce two types of sperms. So this is now a new thing that males produce two types of sperms. Half are X and half are Y. Yes, half are X and half are Y. So these two terms are associated with males only. Males are heteromorphic as well as heterogametic. Clear these two terms? Now come to female. So as you can look into the structure of nature of the chromosomes that female have. So females, they have same type of sex chromosomes. Okay, they can only give X into the gametes. So they have the sex chromosomes. They have two sex chromosomes which are same in size and shape. So here it was different. Now here they are same. So if they are same, we will call them homomorphic. Okay, so females, they have two sex chromosomes which are of same size and shape. So we can call them homomorphic. And moreover, we can call them if males are heterogametic because they are producing two types of sperms, but females are homogametic. Means they are only producing one type of eggs that contains only X chromosomes. ठीक है, हम इनको होमोगेमेटिक बोलेंगे बिकॉज दे आर प्रोड्यूसिंग ओनली एग्स और ओवा विच कंटेन ओनली वन टाइप ऑफ क्रोमोजोम दैट इज एक्स. सो दैट्स व्हाई वी कॉल देम होमोगेमेटिक. सो क्लियर दीज टू टर्म्स. सो मेल्स आर हेटेरोमॉर्फिक एज वेल एज हेटेरोगेमेटिक एंड फीमेल आर होमोमॉर्फिक एज वेल एज होमोगेमेटिक. आई होप दीज टू थिंग्स आर क्लियर. Now let's say, how can we find out the probability of having a male child or a female child during fertilization? Okay, jab fertilization hoti hai, when male and female gametes are fusing with each other. So what is the probability of having a male child and female child? So let's do it according to the genetics via checker method, Punnett square method. So you know that first always we take parent generation. So I will take both. So what we have in parents, we have male and we have one female. Okay. So what is the nature of chromosomes in male? It is 44 plus XY. Okay. And in female, it is 44 plus XS. Because same type of chromosomes are produced. Now, what type of gametes they can contribute? Okay. What type of gametes can be formed from the male? It can be 22 plus X. Either this can go into the gamete or 22 plus Y. Or this combination can go into the gamete formation. Okay? Because why these two are different? Because it contains two types of chromosomes, X chromosomes. So either it can go, it can send X or it can send Y. Because you know that after meiosis, when gametes will be formed, so there will be half the number of chromosomes. That's why I have written 22 here. That we have already, you already know. And in female, what is the probability it can send only X? Because it has only X type of chromosome. Okay. So it can send only X chromosome because it has only X type of chromosome. So we have got the gametes. We have got two gametes from both male and female. Now we can simply put it into the Punnett square method. So I've told you how to do it. First, you have to just represent female male gametes and female gametes. One side is of male and one side is of female. So if I take this side of this side male, so I have from male, which gametes I have, I'll just put it 22 plus X here, 22 plus Y, this side, and female also I have 2. So female 22 plus X here, and again 22 plus X here. Okay, so now just cross it. So what kind of combinations you can get in F1 progeny? So this is your F1 progeny. So what kind of combinations we can get? So just now toss it. So 22, 22 will become 44. At the time of fertilization, you know that they will combine. So 44 plus, we have X here, X and X. So it can be 44 plus XX here. Again, it can be 44 plus X and Y. It can be here 44 plus, which chromosomes we have, XX both sides, so it will be XX. Or here 44 plus, we have Y here and X here, so it will become XY. So now, what did you find? That 50% of the females are there and 50% males. So what can you conclude from this? That at the time of fertilization, there are 50-50% chances that the child may be a boy or can be a girl. Okay, it can be a boy child or it can be a girl child, but that depends. So 50% chances are there it can be a male child or it can be a female child. So we have got from the Punnett square method that 50% it can be a male child or 50% it can be a female child. So how does it depend upon? On which factor? So it depends solely on the chromosomes which are in the male. Okay, so the production of the male child depends only on the male, because the factor which we want for the production of male child, that is only can it can be given by the male only, not by female, because female has only one type of chromosome, that is X. So it can only give X chromosome, which is responsible for having the female child. But if male child is there, so that is only by Y. Okay, so it is in our social community, it is said that if the girl is not having a male child, so they blame girl. So now you have got the scientific proof that a girl cannot be blamed for not having the male child because it does not have the male chromosomes. Okay, so that depends only on the male. That only male is responsible if the couple is not having the male child. So there cannot be any problem in the female. It is only that the male is not able to contribute the Y child, and it is not in the hands of the male. Wo male ke bhi haath mein nahi hai ki that if he will contribute X or Y. It is by the God's will only that which gamete will go into the fertilization process. Okay, so it is a 50-50% chances that male child or female child can have from a couple. So this is the mechanism of sex determination in humans, and we call this mechanism as XXXY mechanism. Okay, so the mechanism of sex determination in human beings is called XXXY mechanism, so that I have made you understood. So if there is any doubt in this, you can ask. So again, I will just quickly recap. So male is producing 44 plus XY. Female, you know that it has 44 plus XX. So in the gamete formation, there can be chances that male can send 22 plus X or 22 plus Y. And female only has one, this sex chromosomes are same. So there is only one possibility of having going sex into the fertilization process. So then it depends on the by Punnett square. We have found that there are chances of 50% male child and 50% of female child we can have. I hope it's clear. Okay. If there is any doubt, you can raise hand. But these are the concepts that you must understand. These are important. Now again, the last very important topic, that is called multiple allelism. Understand it very carefully, because this is very important topic. Okay, we also call it ABO blood group system. हम इसको ABO blood group system भी बोलते हैं. So you know that in humans we have four types of blood groups, A, B, AB and O. So till now, what I have told you, that one gene can have two alleles, that in our body, one gene is represented by two alleles only. Na? For example, if you take the example of height, abhi tak humne kya padha tha? That one gene, for example, you take the height gene, okay? So it has two forms, that is tall and dwarf, okay? So it can be represented by capital T or small t. That means these are what? These are two alleles of the same gene. Okay? Two alleles of the same gene, that is height. Okay? So abhi tak humne ye padha tha, till now we have studied this only, that each gene is can have two alleles. Okay? Either it can have tall or dwarf. That means which is expressed and which is not. So one gene is represented by two alleles till now. But now I say that there is one gene which has more than two alleles, which is represented by more than two alleles. Now, which is that gene? That gene is called I gene. Okay, we call it I gene, and I gene represent what? I gene represent the human blood group. So I gene is responsible for human blood. So I gene can have more than two alleles. So when you can say, when any gene has more than two alleles, more than two alleles, then we will call it multiple allelism. Okay, alleles, you know that I have told you that till now we have studied that one gene is has two alleles, but now I say that there is one gene which has more than two alleles. So which is that gene? That gene is the blood group system. So our blood group is represented by I gene. Remember, now this I gene can have three forms. Okay, it can have IA, or it can have IB, or it can have IO. So you know we have A, the blood group is there, B is there, and O is there. Okay, AB is the combination of A and B. So otherwise we have alleles. How many alleles for I gene? I gene, which is responsible for human blood, okay, this has three forms, IA, IB, and IO. Now these three genes, out of this you can say A and B are dominant genes and O is the recessive gene. Okay, and if there is a combination of A and B both, because you know that AB is also a system, so where there in two alleles will be present, that is IA and IB both. So I have told you that A and B both are dominant, but when both the dominant alleles express themselves, jab dono dominant allele apne aap ko express karte hain, that phenomenon is called codominance. Okay, codominance. Okay, so A and B are dominant, O blood group is recessive, and if the person has a blood group AB, then that is a situation of codominance, because both the dominant alleles have expressed themselves. Clear? Now see, these are the genes. Okay, for I gene we have these three combinations. So these all alleles which are responsible for the blood group, these are present in a population. So all the alleles which are responsible for I gene, that will be present in a population. That means, for example, if four persons are standing in front of me, so that four persons will have different blood group honge, uske A ya B, O, A, B. So then that means I can have all blood group in a population. But if I say a person, so in a person, you know that for every gene, two alleles should be there. Okay, so for A blood group, what will be the combination? So if a person has A blood group, if a person has a blood group A, how it can be represented as? So I told you that a gene has two alleles. Okay, so in our body also, for example, if I have blood group, not if I have, my blood group is A. Okay, so if my blood group is A, so what will be the genotype of my blood group? So this is a phenotype. Phenotype means I have A blood group. So what will be my genotype? Okay, it can be IA, IA. Okay, or it can be IA, I0. Okay, so this I0, jo O blood group hai, for that gene which is responsible allele, that it can be represented by IO also, or simply by small I also. Okay, so it can be represented by small I also, because O is a recessive allele. It's a recessive blood group which contains recessive alleles. So for a person to have O blood group, what is the genotype of that person? First of all, I told you that my blood group is A, so either my genotype will be IA, IA or IO, I0, because this is recessive form. Okay, when both dominant A is there, so obviously then the blood group will be A, that is dominant. But here, if one, you know, this condition, you can relate it with the tall things that we have studied previously. So for having a tall plant, we can have two types of genotype, na? It can have both T's, or it can have heterozygous condition also. So here also, for blood group A, I can have genotype which is homozygous. I can be a homozygous A, or I can be a heterozygous A. Okay? So this is homozygous condition where both the alleles are dominant, and it can be, I can be heterozygous A also, whether I have one dominant allele and one recessive. Clear? Now again, if the blood group of the person is B, so what can be the genotype of that person? So genotype can be where both the alleles are dominant, like this, or it can be where one is dominant and one is recessive. That means it can be a homozygous B or it can be a heterozygous B. Okay? Homozygous may both the alleles will be dominant, but in heterozygous, one dominant and one recessive. Now, if the person has blood group AB, so then what will be the genotype? genotype has only one combination, that is IA and IB. So both the alleles, means alleles of both A and B should be present. So you know that both A and B are dominant alleles. So where both dominant alleles of A and B are present, that means a person will have AB blood group. Okay, so here we are sure that if any person has a blood group AB, so then the genotype of that person will be sure IA and IB. Clear? But here we have doubt, because this is possible in two cases. If a person has blood group A, so there are two chances: a person can be a homozygous A or heterozygous A. Same case in B also, it can be homozygous B or heterozygous B. But in AB, both the AB are dominant, so we know that there's a surety that the genotype of person is IA and IB. We call this codominance. I've already told you. So when both the dominant alleles, they express themselves, that is called codominance. Now, if the person has blood group O, then what will be the genotype? Then also we are sure that the person will have both the recessive alleles. ठीक है, both the recessive alleles, or we can represent it by small, two small eyes also. Like this also we can represent it. Okay, so this is O. So O is the recessive blood group, and AB are both dominant, and AB will come in codominance because here both A and B are present, which are both dominant. Clear? So now see how many phenotypes total and genotypes total are there in human blood, humans, you can say human beings. So in human beings, we can have these four type of blood groups. Okay.